And given that communities are large, they are generally not empowered, and certainly individuals are not a group in our society that is respected, matter of fact, is stigmatized, it's inevitable that there's not going to be the dynamics that help them with resources and also approach. So I see now the job as a monitor is to do two main things, transparency and accountability. Transparency is to open up those windows and those doors and try to get what's happening inside out, and then to really hold those people who are responsible for that accountable. But I believe that a monitor, so this is my opinion, but a monitor cannot work alone. I believe that we constantly have to be working with the community to empower the community and the voices not only those incarcerated, but communities from which they come, to get change, because we can never do it alone. We are a partnership with those that are concerned about fairness and justice and treatment of people humanely. We have to all work together, but we can do that partnership. So that's philosophy. Let's get the nuts and bolts. What we do is we go to 7 to 10 prisons a year. We can go anywhere we want inside the prison, although we're constantly escorted. So I literally go to every housing unit, I go to every program unit, I go to the faraway places that they want to see, absolutely the shoes, mental health units, all the things, we go there and we try to talk to the people. But we have to, one of my main themes, we have to be very concerned about what's going to happen to them. We're asking them to actually share with us something that puts them at risk. So we're constantly as monitors, we have to be very concerned. How can we protect them? So one way we have done that is we have developed a survey that we will mail in to anyone who would like to receive it. It's totally voluntary. But literally we will find sign up 50-70% of the entire population to get a survey that's confidential legal mail for them. Fill out, seal up, and send back to us. And so I have 15,000 surveys from people inside the prison. It's a huge amount of data. I'm a data junkie, I admit, but it really gives the word, and this is, I think, what's very important for monitors. We want to know, I'm showing my age, remember way back, the silent majority, those that are not prepared on their own to file a complaint, file a grievance, they feel intimidated, they feel isolated. I go to the cell and I would say, listen, I'm here, I would like to get information from you, would you like to do it? That is a huge empowerment in itself. And yet, I also am sensitive to concern to share the risk. They can't retaliate against 70% of the population. Versus talking to 15 people or 20 people that they could really focus on. We then write reports about what we observe, we make recommendations, we share that with the agency, we have a conversation about it, and then we issue a public report. They are not, one of the issues, they are not required to respond to us, you know, in writing, although they have agreed to have these conversations about our recommendations before we publish them. But we found that we used to be doing things prison by prison, and that doesn't work. Most of the problems are systemic in nature, and so we have focused on looking at systemic issues. And we've written in-depth reports about several of those topics. But we say doing research and writing reports is less than half the story. The real story is, how do you try to get those information? And we do that in several ways. One is what I call an inside game and an outside game. The inside game is trying to get the agencies, the government's office, and others to do it voluntarily. Often that happens in small instances. There's a problem with the staff. There might be vacancies that they could fill. Things like that can happen. More fundamental problems, though, generally require an outside game. The outside game generally involves legislation, press, coalition building. We are constantly working with coalitions of both experts and community people and directly impacted people. Thus, unless there's community demand, you're generally not going to get change. So we're constantly out there doing that. Another important piece that we believe in is that we want the voices of those inside to be empowered. So if there's a hearing coming up on an issue, literally, I'll send in hundreds of letters to people inside and say, would you like to participate? Here's the address. Here's how you can put those comments in. So we have, in the past, when the legislature was running these hearings, participation directly impacted people inside, they're now getting hundreds of letters from people inside. So that we're trying to make community our most fundamental job to have people who are incarcerated seen and being presented as human beings that have real needs and concerns. And the only way to do that is to bring them forward. And then we try to engage and educate the public and do other things that bring that forward. We also have in our agency trainings for those that are directly impacted to actually get them to the app. So I just want to give a few examples of how this has worked in some respects. And I'm going to talk about two legislative pieces that we have done. One is that we passed we is not just the CEA, that's for our correctional association, but a larger group. We got a law passed called the DOH Oversight Law. It basically required the Department of Health to look at HIV and hepatitis C care in the prisons and in the jails. Because New York was the leader in the country in the highest rates of HIV. At one point, 20% of the women inside had HIV. Now, it's hepatitis C, and just the latest day, we had 24% of the women had hepatitis C. The men were up over 10 and 12%, and now we're down to 3% for HIV. HIV that made U.S. crowds on. And based on that law, the Department of Health had to come in and monitor. They did do a great job, but we pushed. And now in New York, right now in New York State prisons for hepatitis C, they are treating more than 500 people for hepatitis C. Most states are in the order of 50. Some states treat almost no one because it's a very expensive procedure. Also, more than 90% of the people who have HIV, they're on treatment and they are undetected. So there can be success stories. But at the same time, just 4 weeks ago, I testified before the assembly about general medical care. And I do all these surveys. And only 11% of the people that I have surveyed in the last 5 years say that medical care is good, and nearly 50% said it was poor. And what was so interesting to me is I did a report in 2013, and it was a totally different group, and that's this current group is over 4,000, and that group is 7,000 surveys. 11% thought healthcare was good, and about 50% thought it was bad. So we have not fundamentally changed the care system, but we have had exemplary health. Just another issue, anti-Jackson law for pregnant women in prison. In 2009, we have our Women in Prison Project, and they actually worked for years to get a law passed that said you could shackle women. It's so outrageous. When they were in labor and going birth shortly after. This is why monitors are needed, because we monitored that law, and 3 years later we found that 23 out of 27 people that we talked to, they were still being shackled. So in 2015, we got a new law passed, very energized, a lot of work, that said that pregnant women could not be shackled throughout all of pregnancy, and for 8 weeks after pregnancy, they have to report every case to us, and now no women are being shackled. That took a lot of work, it took a lot of effort, but it was also this notion, if you don't, you've got to go beyond policy to actual practices. And then finally, the last one I want to mention about this work is what I call the perfect storm for change. Many of you know that we have this epidemic of mental illness inside of the prisons. And unfortunately, inside of the prisons, those with mental illness are often shuttled to disciplinary confinement in New York. Because if they can't comply with the rules, if they are slow, if they're non-responsive, or if they're difficult behavior, I ride on the subway and if you see people that seem to have mental health needs, you kind of don't get eye contact, but you leave them alone in prison, they end up violating the rules and being sent into solitary. And you have a huge number of people in solitary with mental illness. And they're harming themselves, and suicide, self-harm, and using. So we were, for years, this goes back several years ago, where there was litigation done by the place where I used to work and others. There was a coalition that was concerned about it, and then we were working on a law. The litigation settled, but that litigation was not doing all that they wanted, so we passed a law called the Shoe Exclusion Law that required people to go to work for 4 hours, 5 days a week, when they are in special residential penalty if they have serious mental problems. Okay, so they can be diverted to the special treatment unit for 4 hours a day outside, and it's supposed to be a therapeutic environment. That has happened. We have 200 people there. Some of you might have heard me yesterday make a reference to that. We are getting those people out, but we still have more people with mental health illness in a regular shoot than we ever did. This is kind of confinement, and those units have been fairly punitive in the way they respond to those people. So, it only happened this far because there's this huge amount of work and kind of struggle. Normal education will preempt legislation, but we had such a coalition and worked so hard that we still got the law passed, but it is not solving the problem. So we're now trying to pass a law that will actually restrict all solitary confinement to 15 days, which is the new standard. And we are well on our way. So those are kind of three examples. I now want to talk about models. And there's a few points that I want to make about this. I think monitoring can have many different opportunities. Michelle Deitch, who is a professor at University of Texas, is really the guru on all of this. And when you talk about monitoring, that really is very all-encompassing, and it can be many different components of that. You have people that do regulation, you have people that do investigations and litigation, you have ombudsmen that might deal with particular complaints, you have legal, which is actually lawsuits, many different models. But she puts one that kind of we fit in is monitoring and inspection. And her point about that is a few characteristics. One is that this is supposed to be an ongoing presence that I would call akin to quality assurance. You're trying to work constantly.